The life appearance of non-avian dinosaurs is always an area of much debate and fascinating discussion. From the controversy of lips in theropods to the remarkable transformation of our understanding of the posture many dinosaurs held themselves in when they were alive, the question of what these iconic prehistoric animals would have looked like in the flesh is vital. Not only does it allow paleontologists to gain a greater understanding of their ecology, behaviour and anatomy, but accurately communicating updated ideas of what dinosaurs and other prehistoric animals looked like is incredibly important for the field of paleoart. Paleoartistic reconstructions of ancient organisms have a huge influence on the general public's understanding of prehistoric life, and it's therefore essential, for the sake of effective science communication, that we get this right. One aspect of dinosaur anatomy that is very often inaccurately reconstructed are the feet and hands of sauropod dinosaurs, the iconic long-necked giants of the Mesozoic and the largest animals to ever walk the Earth. These structures are often simply portrayed as very similar to elephant feet, but in fact, they're pretty weird and unique. So I thought it would be fun to take a look at what these parts of the body really looked like in these animals based on our current understanding of their paleobiology. Let's start with the hind feet. In some ways, these did resemble elephant feet to an extent, namely in the fact that, like elephants, a large cushioning fatty pad of soft tissue would have been present at the back behind the digits. This indicates that the hind feet of sauropods would have been semi-digitigrade like elephants too, meaning the heel didn't touch the ground, but it wasn't raised up as high as in some fully digitigrade animals. But that's about as far as the similarities go. Unlike elephant hind feet, those of sauropod dinosaurs were asymmetrical in shape and possessed three, sometimes four in certain species, large claws on the inner toes. These claws stuck out slightly sideways and according to some researchers may have been used to stop the animals slipping as they walked, or perhaps to help them scratch dig. More recent research though has found that they are more likely to have been using these claws to help them excavate nests, like what's seen in some species of tortoises. The outer one or two toes were then simply just small rounded projections that did not even have any claws or probably even nails associated with them, and would have been essentially enclosed within the rest of the foot. Additionally, despite having a cushioning pad similar to elephants, the angle at which the metatarsals, these foot bones, were held doesn't appear to have been as high as the angle seen in these modern mammals. Looking at sauropod hind feet tracks and the anatomy of the bones, this therefore suggests that the toes would have looked slightly longer than some reconstructions show, instead of appearing to just be elephant-shaped feet but with claws. Moving on to the forefeet, or hands now, and this is where things start to get really weird. These structures were nothing like elephant feet at all, despite their portrayal as such in some reconstructions, lacking any sort of fleshy cushioning pad at the back. Instead, the metacarpals are arranged pretty much vertically as pillar-like structures in a semicircle, with the reduced finger bones underneath them, resulting in the back of the hands being concave. Such a condition has been confirmed by the existence of horseshoe-shaped fossil prints left by the front feet of sauropods, illustrating that this unusual semi-tubular shape of the hand was indeed present in life. In addition to not having digits splaying out from the wrist, sauropod forefeet also did not possess claws on each of these digits like is sometimes reconstructed. There would not have been any individual nail-like structures on these digits either, with digits 2 to 5 all being essentially contained within the hand in what has been referred to as a kind of pseudo-hoof, with no distinct digits really being visible from the outside apart from some slight convexities between them. There was, however, a single claw present on the thumb in many sauropods. The exact anatomy of this claw on digit 1 was hugely variable depending on the group of sauropods, with lineages such as the diplodocoids possessing thumb claws that were relatively very large, as well as quite thin and tall in shape, whereas in the titanosauriforms, the thumb claws became highly reduced and eventually seemed to have disappeared altogether in the derived titanosaurs. Interestingly, these derived titanosaurs also completely lost their finger bones too, meaning they would have just been walking around on the ends of their metacarpals. So what might these thumb claws have been used for? Well, all sorts of hypotheses have been put forwards to try to explain their functions, but considering the fact that they're all so different in shape and size depending on the species, it appears as though they were being utilized in a wide variety of ways. Suggestions ranging from purposes in combat to gripping onto tree trunks and digging have been made, but these have still not been completely confirmed. And then there's the mystery of why certain titanosaurs lost them. Interestingly, some sauropods with very large thumb claws, particularly the diplodocoids, would have been capable of slightly lifting them up, though the reason why cannot be said for sure. Another interesting detail that paleontologists have discovered is the fact that some intriguing external soft tissue structures were apparently present on the forefeet in some types of sauropods too. A three-dimensional hand impression discovered in Upper Jurassic rocks in Portugal that was likely left by a brachiosaurid seems to show striations on the sides of the cast caused by the skin of the forefoot, indicating that the hands were covered in a kind of roughened skin with many small spiky tubercles projecting from it. The extent to which this kind of skin was covering the hands isn't known for certain, however, but it's interesting to think that these animals could have had all sorts of strange soft tissue coverings on their feet that couldn't necessarily be predicted from the skeletal anatomy alone, something to keep in mind when reconstructing these organisms. The purpose of such tubercles is, again, currently unknown. It's important to say though, that everything I've been talking about here specifically applies to the eusauropods, the derived grouping of sauropods that excludes more basal earlier forms. This is because non-eusauropod sauropods, essentially more primitive sauropods, are not known for certain to have also possessed such modified forefeet, especially since a lot of these earlier forms were not necessarily needing to support as much weight. The construction of the sauropod limbs are what is known as graviportal, meaning they're well adapted for supporting the great weight of these animals' bodies, and since earlier sauropods and sauropodomorphs were not yet as heavy, it's unlikely that their forelimbs especially were as highly modified as this. However, there is some evidence that earlier sauropods may have actually had semi-tubular hands similar to forms that lived later. Some of the oldest sauropods for which hand material is actually known are the taxa Shunosaurus and Omeosaurus, both from the Jurassic of China, and examinations of this material by researchers indicates that the metacarpals were likely arranged in a semi-tubular arc. The argument then goes that, due to the evolutionary placement of these particular sauropods, it would seem that all eusauropods definitely did have a semi-tubular hand and, by extension, it seems likely that perhaps some more basal sauropods did too. Research published in 2003 that investigated the evolution of the forefeet in these dinosaurs found that the initial arrangement of the hand in a semi-tubular position was potentially not so much to do with supporting a large weight, but was instead the solution to pronating the saurischian hand, meaning this construction was the only way to achieve a palm backwards rather than palm inwards position, due to the way the bones of the arm in these particular dinosaurs are shaped. This would then have put these bones in the ideal arrangement to become massive weight-supporting structures later on, as sauropods eventually grew larger, an example of a pre-adaptation, technically known as an exaptation. So, some very interesting ideas for how such a bizarre morphology could have come about in these animals. I hope this video will be helpful for anyone reconstructing eusauropods in the future. It's always fun to investigate what we currently know about non-avian dinosaur life appearance. So much has been learned in the past few decades, and it's important for this updated understanding to be incorporated into paleoart as it's such a vital part of science communication. Anyway, thank you so much for watching this video, and a big thank you to our patrons too, especially our dinosaur tier supporters Greg Silvernail, George Vojtek, Persian Boy, Mike Pace, Mayer's World, Dhruv Srivastava, Matthias Bergshire, Amanda von Nordek, Just F. Max, Laura Sanborn, Bella Anderson, Harry Evert, T-Patch, and Alain Bally. If you would like to find out more about our world, its history, and the wonderful life that surrounds us all, please feel free to subscribe to the channel if you think we deserve it, and if you would like to see more from us.